The angel said, he's gone. You missed him. She was obedient, but she missed him because she was being obedient. And he was resurrected already because he's Lord of the Sabbath. Well, good morning, everybody. Well, it's that time of year again when we all celebrate the resurrection of our Savior by putting on our Easter bonnet, grabbing our handy basket, and going and hunting for eggs that we colored. And I'm no exception. I mean, who am I? So let's go see if we can find something. Okay, nothing up here, except my giant Zippo lighter. Oh, look at this. Whoa! Guys, there's no eggs here, but it looks like a complete Bible study with some references to this time of year. Well, let's just shed the counterfeit stuff and get on with the stuff that's genuine article. Oh, it looks like the Easter Bunny left me a thermos. And my mug. So, thank you, Easter Bunny. Cheers. So, in all reality, what we have here is the first day of the week. If you're watching this on what's known as Resurrection Sunday, what it's known as in the Bible is the first day of the week. And let me get something. I got a couple things today I'd like to share. So, much like the "you're reading the wrong Bible" video I did, I'm probably practicing the wrong calendar. Because there's Jewish calendars, there's Gregorian calendars, there's priestly calendars, there's Julian calendars, Mayan calendars, there's all kinds of calendars. But the one calendar that is the same every year in the sky is the equinox. When we've got equal, we got vernal, and we got the spring equinox and the fall equinox, okay? When things are like equal. So God uses this clock to determine his times and seasons. So I'd like to show you this real quick as I step over my implements, okay? So take a look at that. So we've got this spring equinox and the first moon. This is going to be very significant in this study. Okay? So we got that. And then we've got the new moon, and we've got then the day one. The biblical new year is 2 days after the spring equinox. It's also called Rosh Hashanah. And then we count days. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Okay? Then that's the Passover. All right? And then the Passover is followed by day one of unleavened bread. Okay? So then you count seven. When you're not supposed to eat leavened bread. We're in the middle of this, according to the calendar I follow. And again, other people follow other calendars that are biblical based, and there's nothing wrong with that. It's just be faithful to the one you're following so you have a rhythm of how you live your life. Biblical things, biblical ways, okay? It's not Jewish. This calendar is older than Jews. Judah did not get the law, okay? Judah sort of kept it, but even failed at that. So that's why we had Jesus have to come and fix everything, because God made a promise in Genesis that he had to fulfill in the quote-unquote Gospels, because man couldn't do it. Okay, so we've got this unleavened bread. Okay, why do we have unleavened bread? Because God, like a new year, wants to have new hearts. And so he wants to give us, have us an understanding. A part of our heart is how we eat. Okay? And leaven is living. Okay? So when you're dumping your bread, it's not worried about baking soda and stuff, whatever. But it's the leaven, like when you make a sourdough bread starter. There's life in the bread. So he wants you to eat bread with no living in, no living matter in it, as a symbol of us starting fresh. So you start a fresh starter, a fresh new year, you reread the scriptures, okay? And you evaluate your life for that 7 days, okay? So that is what it is. It is not a mystical thing. We've got a sky clock that every faith system has some reference to the sky clock. Okay? A sister wrote this. Actually, I was going to read. I'm going to read that too. Okay, so do you see this? God uses his creation so that we can see his appointed times. Now, well, is that in the Bible, Tim? Well, it is in the Bible. So let's start with how we're supposed to do this. Then Adonai, this is Leviticus 23. Now, this Leviticus was written as a handbook to the Levites as to how to conduct the feasts in an orderly fashion so the community of Israel could be following Yahweh in a fashion that would make sense to everyone. So it's easy to answer questions, easy to teach children, easy to see how it coincided with your agricultural rhythm. As you'll see, the first fruits are literal first fruits, because barley comes up first, and then there's a period of time which we call it the 50 days or Pentecost or Shavuot, and then the wheat comes up first. So we have first fruits of barley, first fruits of wheat, okay? Adonai spoke to Moses, saying, speak to Israel, tell them these are the appointed times of Adonai, which you are to proclaim to be holy convocations, my Moedim. Work is for 6 days, the seventh day is rest, holy convocation. It's set apart. Don't do any work. Okay? And these are the appointed feasts of Adonai, holy convocations, which you are to proclaim in their appointed season. During the first month, on the 14th day of the month, in the evening, is Passover. On the 15th day of the same month is the feast of matzo, or unleavened bread. For 7 days, you're to eat matzah. On the first day, you have a holy convocation, so you have some rest on the first day, and then you go through it. So, it just so happens that when Yeshua came, it was the appointed time of the Father, okay? And he fulfilled those appointed times by following the directions in the book. Okay? So, when he was to be crucified, it was Passover. And it was, you know, so it was a time of celebration, time of holy convocation, a lot of things going on. A lot of people had traveled to get to Jerusalem because it was an instruction to celebrate the Passover, to celebrate the unleavened bread. There was all kinds of things going on there. Of course, the Jews had corrupted it, but nonetheless, it was appointed time set apart. So they were there. Now, when Yeshua was Okay, so he was crucified on Passover. Then there was a high Sabbath of the first day of unleavened bread. Okay? And then there was a day, and then there was a Sabbath, and then there was another day. So that's how, we'll go back to this little calendar here. That's how we get the 3 days and three nights. Good Friday is not biblical. There is no such thing as Good Friday. Okay? Jesus was crucified. That day was a Wednesday. I mean, that year fell on a Wednesday. So then he was in the grave Wednesday and Thursday and Friday. And he resurrected on the Saturday. Now, depending on whether you think the day starts in the evening or morning, that's a whole nother deal. But Mary Magdalene didn't go to him on the Sabbath. She went on the first day of the week, the morning. And when she got there in the dawn, she was ripping. She was not messing around. She ran to the tomb, didn't care about the guards, didn't care about nothing. She just cared about her Savior. When she got there, the angel said, "He's gone. You missed him." She was obedient, but she missed him because she was being obedient. And he was resurrected already because he's Lord of the Sabbath. So now we say it's Resurrection Sunday. He didn't resurrect on a Sunday. He resurrected on the Sabbath. She went there on what we call Sunday because she didn't want to do work on the Sabbath. So that's how things got confused. So now here we are, 2,000 years later, trying to sift through the fragments and try to understand the times and seasons of our Father. But a lot of stuff is being unearthed about the times and the seasons. So, how did we come to get bunnies and eggs and Sundays worship and Easter? Okay, here's a very short history by a sister of the faith, and so I'm gonna read this. So if your God and Savior is the Holy One of Israel, why would you worship him according to pagan traditions? Now, what does pagan mean? It just means farmer, you know. It means just someone of a different. You worship creation in some way, shape, or form. Easter, Ostara, Ēostre. Where did we get the term Easter when 90% of the world calls this season Passover, Pascha, Pesach, or Pacas? The Anglo-Saxons were one of the few cultures that refused to drop their pagan name for this season when converting to Christianity. Ēostre, Easter, or Easter in Old English, and Ostara in High German is the name of the Saxon fertility goddess of spring. Ēostre means bright dawn, and this celebration was celebrated at sunrise on the first Sunday after the first full moon following the spring equinox, which is the same tradition the Catholic Church instituted to celebrate Easter and still does to this day. As Christianity spread, the deep roots of pagan spring festivals held strong. Whether it is Ashtoreth, Artemis, Astarte, Ishtar, Isis, or Ēostre, the tradition of celebrating this fertility feast was calculated by the full moon after the spring equinox. So as you can see, since the dawn of time, there has been a false spirit available to worship that God created. You know, God wasn't surprised when the adversary tricked Eve and Adam. God is not surprised about any of this. He calls the adversary up in Job. He calls him at the appointed times. Satan has to go and visit the throne of heaven and talk to Yahweh and explain himself. He has a mission. And his mission is to be a testing spirit to people. So are they going to follow the creation or are they going to follow the creator? Are they going to follow the false rules and the pagan ways or are they going to follow the rules of the Almighty, which are written in the handbook and have been protected down throughout the generations, okay? As Christianity spread, the deep roots of pagan spring festivals held strong. Whether it is, okay, I read that. The early Christian church quickly split over how to calculate the Passover. The church in Jerusalem and Asia Minor held strong for many centuries and celebrated the Passover on the biblical 14th of the first month as God commanded his people in the biblical reckoning of Passover. However, the Western Latin church, influenced by Rome, followed the pagan reckoning of choosing the first Sunday after the first full moon following the spring equinox in order to celebrate the resurrection on a Sunday. This split in the early church was known as the Quartodeciman controversy. The churches in and around Rome sought to supersede and abrogate the biblical practice. Abrogation is when you overlay, and then it says supersede, abrogate. You put your own graphic user interface over the Word of God and do things your way instead of just the way written in the handbook. And that is my entire mission, is to try to make things as simple as possible so that you can get back to the handbook. Back to the handbook is my entire mission. Abrogate the biblical practice of celebrating Passover on the 14th to allow for easy transition for their pagan converts to the Roman Empire's new religion, while at the same time give them an excuse to separate themselves from anything Jewish. So you can blame any but any party that you want. The people that were oppressing the peasants, the oligarchy of the religious hierarchy and the Jewish thing, okay? And or you can blame deception. It doesn't matter. What had happened was people started wanting to do things differently because of the perceived oppression of the Jews. Unfortunately, by compromising with the pagan world back in 325 AD, those pagan traditions still infiltrate the church to this day and still cause many to stumble. The celebration of the true Passover was lost in the compromise of tradition and the mixing of the holy with the profane. God warned us to come out of her, my people, so that you would not share in her sins or contract any of her plagues. Revelation 18:4. That's the New Testament. Okay. Deuteronomy 12:30. Be careful not to be ensnared by their ways after they have been destroyed before you. Do not inquire about their gods, asking, how do these nations serve their gods? I will do likewise. This is Deuteronomy. Okay? This is a letter to the entire nation. One thing you have to understand is there's no law for the Jews. There's no such thing as a Jew in the nation of God. There's a tribe of Judah and the tribe of Benjamin and Asher and Dan and Ephraim and Manasseh. You know, there's all kinds of tribes. There's 12 tribes, right? But the encompassing law is to the nation, and God makes it super duper simple. We're talking Lincoln Logs. You can do deep dives into the wisdom of Yahweh, but if you just want to practice his times, it is the easiest, best thing in the whole wide world because it's just a standard. Zephaniah 1:8. On that day of judgment, says Yahweh, I will punish all those following pagan customs. Thankfully, Yeshua was punished, and so we have an epic amount of mercy. But why would we want to push our Savior into having to advocate for us for doing dumb stuff? That's the question that you got to ask yourself. So what we got here is the same calendar that we've always had. And I wanted to grab something out of Corinthians here because Paul was writing a letter to them. And he was constantly warning them, right? And so I want to say the same thing. 1 Corinthians 2. When I came to you, brothers, I did not come with excellence of speech or wisdom, proclaiming to you the mystery of God, for I decided not to know anything among you except for Yeshua Messiah and him crucified. I was with you in weakness and fear, much trembling. My speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of wisdom, but a demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith would not be in the wisdom of men, but the power of God. We do speak wisdom, however, among those who are mature, but not a wisdom of this age or the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing. Rather, we speak of God's wisdom in a mystery, a wisdom that has been hidden, which God destined for our glory before the ages. None of the rulers of this age understood it, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of God, crucified the Lord of glory. But as written, things no eye has seen, nor ear has heard, that have entered into the heart of mankind. This is from Isaiah. These things God has prepared for those who love him. And then God revealed for the Ruach. So it's not as though you want to hold anything to yourself with pride. And I don't hold anything to myself with pride. I am literally a simple blue-collar man trying to do what's right, taking the basic building blocks of the basic of scripture. Not Jewish, not Roman Catholic or any Protestantism or modern tradition. I am just wanting to share with you the power of the truth of the Word of God and how it can relieve you. It can bust the shackles. Whether you're Jewish and tied to the Jewish rules of their Jewish tradition, 1,000 rules about Shabbat, or whether you are quote-unquote Christian and you're tied to their rules of tradition where they do things that are abrogating the truths in Scripture. It twists Scripture. It's like it almost throws it away. Twisting Scripture seems to be almost like too kind, right? And so God's Word has never changed. God wrote His Word in the beginning. He wrote it in the beginning before the foundations of the earth. Our Messiah was crucified before the foundations of the earth because God knew that they were going to have to do something. By they, I mean Elohim is a plurality. We got the Father and the Son. So I'm just appealing to y'all in this season of spring and new beginnings that you can look at the Word of God, find the new beginnings, have a fresh start, to throw away the man's traditions and to pick up the proper traditions and faith walk of a holy God. So with that, I pray you guys have a blessed day. If you are celebrating the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, take a look at what the message he was trying to tell us. Our Lord and Savior was resurrected. He was crucified and resurrected because he deemed it that he was going to fulfill a promise he made with Abraham. It is the faithfulness of God that saves us. It is not your faithfulness. It is God's faithfulness. It is the blood of Yeshua Messiah that is justice. He justifies before the holy God to pay the death penalty of the covenant of the bull and the sacrifice made in Genesis 15. If you want to understand Jesus, you got to understand Genesis. If you want to understand the Father and the Son and the work and the work, the works, the rules, then you got to understand Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. If you want to understand Paul, you have to understand the Torah. If you want to understand anybody, you need to understand the beginning of the book before you get to the end of the book. Like any book, would you walk into a physics class, a 300 or 400 physics class, not understanding the 101? You would not do that with math. You would not do that with science. You would not do that with, could you go fly a 747 if you haven't taken the basic aircraft schools? And then once you did, do you forget your basic training when you are flying a large airplane? No. Why do people think we can do that? Why do people think we can just go to the end of the book and then understand the beginning of the book? You can't. And the fact of the matter is, the beginning of the book is super easy to understand. It's super locked in. It's man confounding the wisdom of God to other men that cause complications in the systems of religion and tradition that we have today. It is not the Word of God that is complicated. So, Jesus was resurrected yesterday. Mary found him today. And we get to enjoy the blessed paid for life that we live moment by moment. I'll talk to y'all later.
What's up, Rosie? Okay, my little murderer.
Oh, by the way, if you got red squirrels, get a cat.